Welcome to EPG Pathshala. My name is Shoma Mukherjee. I am an assistant professor in the Center for Comparative Literature, Bhasha Bhavan, Vishwabharati. Today I am going to talk about a particular module in the paper African Caribbean Literatures in English. The title of the module is Amata Aidu, Anua, the Play. Today we will discuss several points about the author, the woman writer Amata Aidu, the biographical detail about Amata Aidu, the basic background and context of the play, and then we will talk about the major themes of the play Anua, and then we will talk about the major characters of the play. Amata Aidu, her Christian name was Christiana Amata Aidu, was one of the famous woman writers of contemporary Africa. She was born in 1942 in Salt Pond, the central region of Gold Coast, present-day Ghana. Her father was chief of Abiyadzi Kiyakar, a royal Fante family. His name was Nana Yo Fama, and Aidu's mother's name was Mame Abesema. In spite of his nationalist beliefs, Aidu's father sent his daughter to Wesley Girls High School in Cape Coast to complete her education. Later on, Amata Aidu had completed her graduation degree in English from University of Ghana in Legon. Then now we will talk about little bit about Aidu's achievements. In her later academic career, Aidu went on to visit Stanford University for a fellowship in creative writing. Later point of time, she became a research fellow at the Institute of African Studies, University of Ghana, and lecturer in English at the University of Cape Coast. In 1982, she had been appointed as Minister of Education under the Jerry Rawlings administrations. Now we can talk about few of her writings, her major works. Her first play, The Dilemma of a Ghost, was published in 1964. In this play, a Ghanaian man, Otto, returned to his homeland from United States with an African-American wife. He had not informed his family about the marriage, and the whole play is about a conflict between two different worldviews, the traditional and the modern. Amata Aidu started her literary career during her university days. Few of her famous and celebrated writings are the following, like Dilemma of a Ghost, it is a play published in 1965. Anua, the play which we are going to discuss today, the publication date is 1970. Our Sister Killjoy, or Reflection from a Black-Eyed Squint, it is a novel published in 1977. No Sweetness Here is a famous collection of short story of Amata Aidu and was published in 1970. Someone Talking to Sometime is a poetry collection of Aidu. It was published in 1985. Changes, a Love Story, another novel of Aidu, was published in 1991. The Girl Who Can and Other Stories is a collection of short story and it had been published in 1997. Now we will talk about the major themes in Aidu's writing. In all her writings, one can find some common themes such as the conflict between traditional and modern values, African and Western worldviews, legacy of slavery and its influence on Ghanaian society, and so on. In her most controversial novel, Our Sister Killjoy, which was published in 1977, Aidu criticizes newly educated youths who, after migrating to the West for their education, most of the time choose a life of comfort and decided to never come back to their own country. She also initiated debate about the role of African women in modern Ghanaian society and how in the colonial as well as in the neo-colonial state, quandary of African women has not changed. Now we can talk about the background of the play Anwa and the political context of the play Anwa. In spite of official abolishment of slavery into the early half of 19th century Europe, it was a profitable and ongoing project on the west coast of Africa into the 1830s and 40s. Critics and historians of West Africa have agreed that legal abolishment did not deter people from venturing into the profitable business of slavery. Also, this period saw an increased flow of human traffic, both in domestic and transatlantic levels. On the regional level, in the early half of 19th century, in the Gold Coast, the Asante and the Fanti were involved in a continuous conflict of dominance, as the Asante of the interior was striving to expand their control to the coastal area, through which they could maintain their own Atlantic trade. Incidentally, we would like to refer back to the fact that Asante and the Fantis are two communities who were living in Gold Coast at that point of time. On the other hand, the Fanti were trying to retain their dominion of coastal area because in this area they already had commercial and political tie-up with British traders. Set against this general backdrop of domestic as well as transatlantic slave trade, the play Anwa talks about the bond of 1844, an agreement through which British colonial power gained a trading priority in the Fanti area. The dramatic action of the play takes place about 30 years after this treaty had been signed between these two groups. The treaty did happen. The play actually talks about the crucial historical and economic junctures where the narratives of the colonialism and capitalism merged with each other. Now we will talk about the source from which Amata Aidu borrowed the basic story structure of the play Anwa. The play Anwa borrows its story from an old Ghanaian legend folktale about a beautiful but headstrong young girl who marries a man of her choice, going against her parents' wish and rejecting several prospective proposals. But quite expectedly, the husband turns out to be a devil in disguise. If we look at the play Anwa, then we will find several characters. Among them, the major characters are Anwa, the heroine of the play, Kofi, her husband, Badua and Osam, Anwa's father and mother, the old man and the old woman, or the mouth that eats salt and pepper. These are the characters. Now I am going to talk about the characters, and through the character analysis, I will talk about the basic story structure of the play Anova. Anova is the central character of the play Anova. In the first phase of the play, she comes across as a beautiful, free-spirited girl who rejected several of her marriage proposals. She falls in love with a beautiful man called Kofi. In spite of her mother's stiff resistance, Anova marries Kofi and leaves her own town, Yebi, by saying that she is not going to come back again to her family. Till this point, Anova comes across as a girl who is not only physically beautiful, but she is beautiful inside. But she is also a little bit headstrong, proud, etc. Interestingly, for a matrilineal setup, Anova's action of severing all ties with her family makes her a pariah whose husband becomes her only living connection, that as if she left all her earlier human relations, flesh and blood connection, like her mother and father and her maternal connections, for her husband, that is Kofi. Later point of time, we will encounter a situation where Anova and Kofi are living together. Anova, she toils hard with her husband to establish a business of selling animal skins. But later on, a conflict rises its ugly head when Kofi decides to buy slaves for his business. In spite of Anova's vehement opposition, Kofi becomes a fat, bejeweled slave trader. Now we will talk about Kofi Akko, the husband of Anova. In first phase of the play, Kofi will come across as a person who is handsome, who is physically beautiful. Kofi Akko is the man with whom Anova falls in love. Anova's mother vehemently opposed the alliance because, according to her, Kofi is the proverbial handsome but good for nothing guy. In the town of Yebi, Kofi is from Ensona family, whose men have been known to make the best of husbands. But Badua has her own reservations against Kofi. Incidentally, Badua is the mother of Anova. So Badua has her own reservation against Kofi, as Kofi's grandfather gave him a business of palm trees and his uncle gave him virgin land. And in the both the instances, Kofi was unable to make proper use of it. Like, he fails in his endeavor to succeed in life. Anova and Kofi get married and leave the town with a promise to never to come back to Yebi. Now we will talk about the characters Badua and Osam. Badua is the mother of Anova and Osam is the father of Anova. From the beginning of the play, Badua comes across as a worried mother who is looking for prospective bridegroom for her daughter. According to Badua, a woman's success lies in the fact that whether she is beautiful or not, but it is also about the fact that whether that particular girl has a loving husband or not, and how many children that particular woman actually produced. So Badua actually wants this kind of life for her daughter, her beautiful daughter Anova. Osam, the father of Amnua, seems to be a restrained and judicious person who does not react violently. Osam wants his daughter to be an apprentice of a priestess. But Badua, the mother of Anua, wants domestic bliss for her daughter. Now we will talk about the other characters, other major characters like the old man and the old woman, or the play actually describes these characters as the mouth that eats salt and pepper. One of the crucial dramatic element which Amata Aidu had introduced in her play Anua is the dual choric figure of the mouth that eats salt and pepper. We can think about the Greek tragedy where we encounter, say, choric characters, the chorus, who will talk about the situation of the play. They will talk about the characters and their reactions, their mental as well as their physical well-being, etc. Like the choric elements in Greek tragedy, here we have found the old man and the old woman. They are not only introduced the main characters like Anua, Kofi and the other characters. Simultaneously, they are the narrator of the immediate dramatic actions as well as past occurrences. Like the Greek chorus, they clarify and offer judgment on the actions of the play. This interpretative nature of their character points out towards a tendency through which they are trying to understand why things have come to be the way they are. Now we will talk about the oral nature of the play Anua, or maybe how orality became one of the main characteristics of Anua, the dramatic structure of the play Anua. Although Anua has the structure of a traditional play, it quite successfully combines verse, prose, song, mime within its dramatic periphery. It combines the oral and written, traditional and the modern literary traditions by including proverbs, oral idioms and colloquialism with choric elements of Greek play. On the whole, as a play, Anua depicts a crucial socio-historical economic juncture of colonialism where it shows how slave trade and its associated paraphernalia had transformed the whole history of civilization in general and African history in particular. As a whole, if we look at the play Anua by Amata Aidu, then we will realize that in the play, Kofi in the end comes across as someone who has been affected by colonialism and colonial doctrines. And Anua in the end of play committed suicide as well. Before that, Kofi actually committed suicide. Anua, till end is a childless woman, where in her own society, she the usual custom, the usual way of success has been judged by the fact that how many children a woman can produce. In this respect, Anua comes across as someone who is a failure in her life. But the critics are saying that Anua is a text which actually talks about the aftermath of colonialism and how colonialism actually affected the indigenous communities and their lifestyles as well as their ideologies. When we are talking about the slave trade in African continent, If we look at all the details, then we will realize that the transatlantic slave trade was abolished in Denmark in 1803. In England, it was abolished in 1807. In the USA, in 1808. In the Netherlands, in 1814. And in France, both in 1794 and again in 1880. But in spite of these official announcements, transatlantic and domestic slave trade used to be a thriving business on the west coast of Africa and 1830s and 40s. Anwar has been set in this context, and it actually talks about the fact that how slavery, the idea of slavery and slave trade actually affected the indigenous community. In the beginning of their conjugal life, Anwar and Kofi are in love with each other, but in later point of time, Kofi became a person who actually exploited several people. He imprisoned several people as his slave, and he became a flat, bejeweled slave trader. And the play actually suggests, because of these occurrences, because of these kind of exploitative things, like the things Kofi is doing to the other people, Anwar and Kofi were childless till the end. And there is a suggestion within the play where Anwar is accusing Kofi as Kofi is someone who is important, and Anwar is blaming Kofi that just because he is talking about or he is benefiting from the slave trade, that's why he's that's why he is still an important man. These kind of literary text, several of if we look at the African literatures, or maybe literatures of Africa throughout the African continent, then we will find several writers who are talking about, who are dealing with the theme of slave trade, or maybe the theme of importance in literatures. Some of the literary examples are Semben Usman's Hala. Semben Usman Hala actually talks about El Haji Abdul Qadir Bey, and in spite of his materially a successful man in life, but in the beginning of play, he comes across as someone who lost his capacity to produce children. Several writers of African origins have centered their play, their novel, their short stories around the theme of slavery. Some of the examples are Ghanaian Amar Taidu's Anwar, published in 1970, Nigerian Buchi Emecheta's The Slave Girl, which was published in 1971, South African-born Botswana naturalized Bessie Head's Maru, which was published in 1971. Another common theme which has been dealt is theme of male impotency, and the literary examples of the same theme are Amar Taidu's Anwar, which we have discussed today. Another famous example is Semben Usman's novel Hala. As a concluding remark about the play Anwar, if we look at the play, then we will understand that there are, as far as the play structure is concerned, it's the mixture of the technique of drama prevalent in West as well as the drama technique prevalent in Africa, more specifically Ghana. Several writers of African origins have talked about several themes, like the themes of slavery and the themes of male impotency. Amata I Do's play Anua actually talks about both the theme, like the theme of slavery and the theme of male impotency. The story of the play Anua actually talks about the fact that how a beautiful woman individually actually affected by the idea of slavery and its different manifestations. There are several other writers from the African continent, from the continent Africa, who actually talks about these themes. Besides Anua, there are several other writers, women writers, like Nigerian Buchi Emecheta, whose The Slave Girl actually talks about the theme slavery. The text was published in 1971. If we look at the other famous woman writer of the continent, Bessie Head, the South African-born Botswana naturalized Bessie Head's Maru actually talks about the idea of slavery and how it affected a community, the Bushmen community in Botswana. Another common theme which has been dealt in the plague Anua is the theme of male impotency. Besides Anua, Amata Aidu's Anua, the other famous example from literatures of Africa which was centered around the theme male impotency is Semben Usman's Hala. So if we look at Amata Aidu's Anua, then it will connect several other texts, and then it actually talks about the basic nature of colonialism prevalent in Africa, in the continent Africa, and how the colonialism as an oppressive exploitative system actually affected the lives of the different communities in Africa. Thank you.